Good evening, everyone. Thank you so much for being here. My name is Emily Channell-Justice. I am the director of the Temerty Contemporary Ukraine Program here at the Ukrainian Research Institute, Harvard University. And I'd like to welcome you to the 2022 Zenovia Sochor Parry Memorial Lecture in Ukrainian Politics. So the Zenovia Sochor Parry Memorial Lecture in Ukrainian Politics was established here at the Ukrainian Research Institute in 2000. Dr. Zenovia Sochor Parry was a professor at Clark University, significant and respected scholar in the field of Soviet and East European history and politics. And from the early 1980s until her death in February 1998, she was a member of the Harvard Ukrainian Research Institute. So this lecture is a biennial event designed to showcase the work of scholars and practitioners who are working in all areas of contemporary Ukraine. This year's Sochor Parry Memorial Lecturer, Catherine Wanner, joins an illustrious list of speakers, which have included Oleksiy Honcharuk, the former prime minister of Ukraine, Mark Beisinger, Volodymyr Panyoto, Angela Stent, and Timothy Snyder, among others. Tonight's Sochor Parry Memorial Lecture is co-sponsored by the Minda de Gunzburg Center for European Studies, as well as the Anthropology Department at Harvard University. And I'm very delighted to get to introduce Catherine Wanner, who is professor of history, anthropology, and religious studies at Penn State University, and who has been doing ethnographic research in Ukraine and about Ukraine for 30 years. Her work has had a profound influence, not just on me as a scholar, but on anthropology of religion, and of course, on the practice and writing of anthropology about Ukraine. Her book, The Burden of Dreams, History and Identity in Post-Soviet Ukraine, which came out in 1998, was the second ethnography that I ever read about Ukraine. The first one was Adriana Petrina's Life Exposed, by the way. But this book in particular, it really, I think, and I think Kathy's work does this so well, it embodies the use of ethnography to present a snapshot of a moment in time, and then it extrapolates the significance of everyday practices to answer big picture questions about history, memory, and nation building. In general, I think this is one of the best contributions of ethnographic research and how it makes an important impact on scholarly thinking. And I think it's one of the main reasons that Kathy's work continues to resonate. So her new book is Everyday Religiosity and the Politics of Belonging in Ukraine. It came out this year with Cornell University Press, and I think it does the same thing. It's a snapshot of a moment in time before February 24th. It talks about everyday practices, and it looks at how Ukraine is positioned within much bigger questions than just about things like national sovereignty, although it talks about that as well. So in tonight's talk, she will draw from this book to compare the religious landscape in Ukraine prior to the Russian invasion and consider how it has changed and what we might expect in the future. So please join me in welcoming Kathy Wanner. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Emily, for the very kind introduction and for the invitation to be here. I should also say that it's really a distinct personal pleasure for me to be delivering the Zenovia Sochor Parry Memorial Lecture, in that I met her at a very pivotal period. I was a first-year graduate student at a conference on Chernobyl. It was the fifth year anniversary of the Chernobyl catastrophe. And as a first-year graduate student, I gave a paper at this conference, which was, now looking back, was a rather bold thing to do. And it was a room full of political scientists and historians. I was the lone anthropologist, of course, and I was one of a very few who was not of Ukrainian origin, who was doing research on Ukraine. And Zenovia made a special point of coming up to me and offering words of encouragement and support that I remember very, very clearly even today. It's difficult for me to imagine that that was over 30 years ago, but she made a very profound impression on me at a very early and pivotal moment in my career. So it's really a great pleasure for me and a great honor to be delivering a lecture in her name in particular. So at this moment, a very difficult moment for Ukraine, I wanted to speak a little bit about the role of religion in war. So the full-scale Russian invasion of Ukraine that began on February 24th, 2022, was for many unimaginable. Even more unimaginable has been the violence and destruction unleashed on Ukrainians by Russian forces. This war has and will continue to incite staggering changes on multiple levels, religious as well as political. Certainly for the region, but also for the world at large. So I'd like to think about the role of religion in this war. And if religion is politics by other means, how and why has religion been used? And to what effect? So along with bombs on the front to either secure or undermine Ukrainian state sovereignty, there's a parallel conflict raging among Orthodox institutions over the fate of Orthodoxy in the region. Weaponizing religion means making religion a very hard form of soft power. This is not the first religious war of the 21st century, as some have claimed, but it is a war with very significant religious dimensions and one in which religious organizations, clergy, and religious symbolism play an important role. And moreover, I believe they will continue to do so in the aftermath of this war. So today I'll argue that religion is a powerful undercurrent in this war in Ukraine and beyond because it plays a key role in defining relatedness. It does this by fostering certain moods and motivations to act that connect or divide people from each other and to specific places. However, efforts to weaponize and securitize religion to advance political agendas must contend with widespread vernacular religious practices, which is the main vehicle that informs relatedness and belonging. So demonstrating the world-making and breaking, world-breaking capacities of religiosity, it's essential to note that although Orthodoxy is currently used to legitimate violence and incite the will to fight, religious actors are also one of the most likely to help advance conflict resolution, peacekeeping, and even reconciliation, not just between Russians and Ukrainians, but also among Ukrainians. And so for this reason, it merits our attention to take stock of what the religious landscape was like before the war, how it seems to be evolving, and why religion has the power to persuade and motivate to the degree that it does. So as Emily mentioned, I'm a cultural anthropologist, and I use ethnographic methods of long-term participant observation and interview-based research. So this allows me to offer an analysis of what religiosity means and the forms it takes, both prior to the war and the difference they make now. From 2010 to 2020, I systematically interviewed people who claim to be non-religious, non-affiliated, and just Orthodox, prosto pravoslavni. Until recently, the just Orthodox were the largest single religious group in Ukraine, and reflecting the extent to which religious affiliation, and specifically declaring oneself just Orthodox, is a political position, only after Russian troops began amassing on the Russo-Ukrainian border in November 2021, did the percentage of people claiming to be just Orthodox slip below the percentage of those allied with the Orthodox Church of Ukraine. Nearly 3 years after an independent Ukrainian church was created and under the threat of impending military aggression, the just Orthodox became the second largest group 3 years after the church was formed. And since the full-scale invasion of February of this year, their ranks have slipped even further. However, the dynamics that made the just Orthodox, I strongly suspect, remain and will continue to remain. The just Orthodox are significant because they are swing voters of sorts. They're able to influence the fate of Orthodoxy in Ukraine and by extension in Russia, and in the greater Orthodox Christian world. So prior to the invasion, about 2/3 of the Ukrainian population considered themselves Orthodox, and it's already up to 73%. When we take inventory of all that has been destroyed because of this war, among the casualties is likely to be the option of considering oneself just Orthodox, as opposed to proclaiming an allegiance to a particular religious institution associated with a patriarch who resides in Kiev, Moscow, or Constantinople. The just Orthodox, or prosto pravoslavni, reflect a type of community and means of self-identification that was amorphous and yet prevalent prior to the war in Ukraine. I'll consider how the just Orthodox relate to those who proclaim an affiliation with the Ukrainian Orthodox Church of the Moscow Patriarchate, and close by offering some preliminary reflections as to what we might expect in the months and years to come, regarding the deinstitutionalization of religious practice, the sacralization of public space, and the vanishing secularity of history, before turning to your comments and questions. So let's get started. So Ukraine's legacy as a borderland where multiple empires have historically met, the Austro-Hungarian, the Ottoman, and Russian, has bequeathed it cultural attributes that are often flexible, expansive, and poorly represented by established categories for studying religion, nationality, and even conflict. So in Ukraine and elsewhere in the Slavic world, even non-believing, non-practicing people can feel an attachment to orthodoxy. And this is what makes religion a political resource that can be effectively weaponized in defense of state sovereignty or a driver of imperial ambitions. Prostopravoslavny could be translated as simply Orthodox, but I understand this group to be setting a limit, which is why I translate it as just Orthodox. They proclaim an allegiance to a confessional tradition, Eastern Christianity, but withhold allegiance to a particular patriarch. They're neither undecided nor unprepared for denominational choice, as some have suggested. Rather, their embrace of orthodoxy is distinctly elastic, capable of blending vernacular religious practices with established institutions of Eastern Christianity. The just Orthodox are evidence of a certain soft confessionalism in Ukraine and begin to explain why religion has been so instrumentalized in this war. Max Berkholz studied the localized violence among neighbors in former Yugoslavia during World War II and concluded that violence is a generative force. Violence, he writes, propels multiple simultaneous transformations in the meaning of ethnic categories and boundaries in profound surges, and in doing so, creates new forms of local communities. The Russo-Ukrainian War, like so many others, has also generated new identities, institutions, concepts, and practices. Violence has reordered religious affiliation, transformed secularism as a political principle, and altered the language many people prefer to speak. All of this in turn has further generated changes in public institutions, public space, and the religious landscape. So let's consider how this came about. I want to just share my screen with you. Oops, sorry. There we go. So perhaps for some of you, this series of events is well known, but it's worth recalling that as threats to Ukrainian sovereignty mounted, thanks to a Russian-backed insurgency in eastern Ukraine that began in 2014 and unleashed hybrid forms of warfare, a parallel effort ensued to strengthen Ukrainian state borders and fortify a sense of Ukrainian nationhood that centered on securing an autonomous Ukrainian Orthodox Church independent from the Russian Orthodox Church. In other predominantly Orthodox countries, there's a single Orthodox Church according to the principle of one people, one church. And of course, this is why we have the Romanian Orthodox Church, the Bulgarian Orthodox Church, and so on. So after nearly 30 years of independent statehood and against the backdrop of a hybrid war, then Ukrainian President Petro Poroshenko spearheaded efforts that prompted the Ecumenical Patriarchate in Constantinople to reassert authority over religious life in Ukraine and grant a tomos of autocephaly to the Orthodox Church of Ukraine. So the creation of an independent church revitalized the essential, even pivotal, importance of the Ecumenical Patriarchate in Constantinople for the Orthodox world. The key point is that in 2019, for the first time in over three centuries, Moscow no longer governed religious life in Ukraine. So this resulted in a bifurcated choice of institutional affiliation, but one that was freighted with political connotation. Ukraine became the first country in the Eastern Christian world to have two canonically recognized Orthodox churches supposedly serving the same people. And the choice was framed as either, as you see here, the Orthodox Church of Ukraine under the Ecumenical Patriarchate in Constantinople with religious leadership in Kyiv and an implicit endorsement of European integration, or the Ukrainian Orthodox Church of the Moscow Patriarchate, which implies religious and political subordination to Russia. It's important to note that the liturgical, doctrinal, and aesthetic traditions of both institutions stem from the same confessional heritage. Political convictions usually drove the choices that people made, and therefore the differences between the churches have to be forged in liturgical particularities or in their understandings of the past and their visions of the future. And in this case, those factors diverge quite sharply among these two churches. Although 2014 was something of a turning point, prior to the invasion, the Just Orthodox still largely entered or attended a church irrespective of jurisdiction. The same was not true, though, for life cycle rituals, when most people made a conscious selection of which church to baptize a child in, which church to marry in, or which member of the clergy to call on to conduct a burial service. As swing voters, the Just Orthodox will play a key role in how the Orthodox Church of Ukraine might fare. And the stakes are very high for the Russian Orthodox Church, which explains why it fought so valiantly to block its creation. At that time, fully one third of the Russian Orthodox parishes were in Ukraine, which partially explains the 200 churches program, Zvesti Hramov, of in-churching, as it's called. This initiative aimed to put a church within walking distance, as defined by less than 1 kilometer, of every Muscovite by 2023. And that goal was achieved already in 2019. But in addition to a significant number of parishes located in Ukraine that are connected to the Russian Orthodox Church, 3 of the 5 most important monasteries for Eastern Slavs are in Ukraine and are part of the Ukrainian Orthodox Church of the Moscow Patriarchate. So even if the Moscow Patriarchate uses these churches and other buildings on monasterial grounds, the land under them is controlled by the Ukrainian state. So I wanted to show you some statistical research that has been done by the Kiev International Institute of Sociology. They are the only ones that I know of that have conducted research during the war. And here you see as recently as July 2022 on religious affiliation. So in some instances, some of the results are not surprising. There, as you see, there is a rise in the number of people who proclaim an affiliation with the Orthodox Church of Ukraine. We similarly see a decline among those who proclaim that they're just Orthodox, as well as a fairly significant decline among the Ukrainian Orthodox Church of the Moscow Patriarchate. But what I want to draw your attention to is the way in which this particular survey was conducted. That is to say, here you see across regions the results. But the choice that was given was either this bifurcated choice that I had just presented to you. And those numbers for the Just Orthodox have to do with those who insisted on being Just Orthodox. So in other words, it's still quite significant in my mind that even 5 months into the war in Ukraine as a whole, 16% insist, in other words, refuse to articulate an allegiance to the Ukrainian Orthodox Church of the Moscow Patriarchate or the Orthodox Church of Ukraine and still continue to maintain their just Orthodox status. And that's in part driven by the way in which the questions are posed. This is a survey over time from another, the Razumkov Center, that offers the possibility of identifying oneself as just Orthodox. And you'll see there's a fairly consistent block of people that identify as just Orthodox over time. This is a slide from the Razumkov Center. And here you'll see this is the top line. I apologize for the Ukrainian, for those that don't read Ukrainian. The top line is the Orthodox Church of Ukraine. And then comes the Orthodox, yes, and the second one then is the Ukrainian Orthodox Church of the Moscow Patriarchate, and on the bottom is the... Okay, sure. That's all right. We're going to just move this screen so that it...
Oh, So sorry. There we go. Sorry
about that. That's okay. Thank you. And I'm sorry if people couldn't see earlier. The essential point I just wanted to show here is that this data was collected in November 2021. And you see for the first time here where the those who affiliate with the Orthodox Church of Ukraine begins to outpace those who claim to be just Orthodox. Unfortunately, now it's not. Let me see if I can. It's not advancing. There we go. So let's think about these just Orthodox. So prior to the invasion, I mean, the just Orthodox deliberately rejected selecting a denomination as a political statement in and of itself. They rejected a polarized choice between either a pro-Ukrainian or pro-Russian church and chose instead a category that reflects an embrace of a confessional tradition. However, as the greater political context changed and the threat of military intervention grew, allegiances shifted as the imperative to make other political statements emerged. As Russian troops were amassing on the Russo-Ukrainian border in November 2021, you see then the shift which I just showed you. So almost 3 years after its creation, those who affiliate with the Orthodox Church of Ukraine surpassed those who declared themselves just Orthodox. Choosing to be just Orthodox after the full-scale invasion implies refraining from condemning the Russian Orthodox Church, and this has become impossible to growing numbers of Orthodox, and hence we see their numbers, along with the adherence to the Ukrainian Orthodox Church of the Moscow Patriarchate, declining. However, the dynamics that created the just Orthodox remain robust. And if anything, I think they have intensified. And I'll be speaking about that in just a moment. So the just Orthodox intrigued me because I quickly realized that very few of the established categories and concepts that we use to study religion applied to them. And some were even outright misleading. Even the word religion itself was problematic. When I posed questions concerning religion, as opposed to vera or faith, I received entirely different answers. Questions regarding religion usually elicited blank stares, evasiveness, or charges of arrogant, distant clergy and self-serving coercive institutions of which they're a part. Whereas questions concerning faith, with no mention of religion, often brought forth references to a spiritual advisor, a duchovnik, and to the meaningfulness of this relationship. When speaking of faith, people made references to the illustrious role of Orthodoxy and that it has played in enriching and even defining Eastern Slavic civilization and its numerous accomplishments in the domains of art, architecture, and learning, rather than criticizing the profiteering, power-driven nature of religious institutions, which they did when they spoke of religion. Many just Orthodox claim that they're not religious. Few attend church services, and fewer still participate in church-based rituals, such as communion. Some do not know basic doctrines, such as the Ten Commandments. Yet they pray regularly, go to church to light a candle, participate in pilgrimages, and attend exhibits, concerts, and performances with religious themes. When I saw the just Orthodox actively practicing their faith in pervasive and public ways, and I noted the enormous political influence religious institutions wield, I concluded that people indeed believe, but not always in religion, and that they practice to belong, but not always to a church. The allegiance of the just Orthodox is to a faith tradition, more so than a specific institutional structure, to moral authorities who might be clergy as easily as they could be spiritual advisors, poets, or writers, and to honoring the sacred, which they might find in cemeteries, nature, or at monuments, far more often than in a church. In short, to learn about Orthodox religious practices and beliefs, it became clear to me that it's best not to mention religion, and church might not be the best place to go. And all of this has shaped practice and political orientations in decisive ways prior to the invasion. So let's think about how a person might become just orthodox. So I'll argue that an effective atmosphere of religiosity exists in Ukraine and was fueled primarily by three sources: religious signs in public space, religious actors in public institutions, and vernacular religious practices. An atmosphere of religiosity fosters dispositions, inclinations, orientations, and convictions, religious and political, that affect indifferent agnostics, committed atheists, and pious believers alike. The atmosphere of religiosity that exists in Ukraine forms the backdrop to everyday experiences and extraordinary events, including this war, that characterize the life worlds of Ukrainians. The power of atmosphere lies in the ability to either intensify or mute sensations that inform experiences. When an atmosphere becomes effective, it influences how experiences are understood and the reactions they ignite. A particular atmosphere that permeates everyday life can generate sensations and vistas, such that indifferent agnostics become no longer so indifferent, committed atheists no longer so committed, and believers more pious. Of course, the reverse is equally as true. The point is that an atmosphere can provoke and persuade people to feel, think, and act differently. Some anthropologists have tried to capture the nature of religiosity in Orthodox societies by remaking Grace Davies' succinct depiction of the English as displaying attitudes towards religion that could be characterized as believing without belonging. Jean Kormina suggests that belonging without believing is more appropriate for Russians, who are part of what she calls a church of the unchurched. Michael Epstein refers to minimal religion to depict the Russian blending of mysticism, theosophy, and faith, pure and simple, with estrangement from religious institutions. In Ukraine, the attachments the just Orthodox have to institutional religion are more complex. They call themselves casual believers, sympathizers, prihilniki, or atheists with traditions. They sincerely engage in religiosity as a form of self-help in response to the beat of cultural and political rhythms and out of a desire for cultural belonging, but they do it on their own terms. The vernacular qualities of this lived everyday religiosity simultaneously accommodate a guarded distance and an active attachment to institutional structures, a refusal to be coerced by them, and the desire to belong to something greater than themselves. Vernacular religiosity is the vehicle to overcome institutional disaffection and suspicion of clergy while capitalizing on the validation and authentication of sacred status and correct practice those institutions and their leaders offer to sites, objects, and people. And this makes for important differences between the just Orthodox in Ukraine and the Orthodox in Russia, as well as the growing number of so-called nuns in North America and Europe, who decline allegiance to a particular denomination and faith tradition on the grounds that they are spiritual and not religious. Then I am referring there, of course, to the nuns in North America and Europe. The just Orthodox refrained from committing to a particular Orthodox institution, but affirm an allegiance to a faith tradition and the everyday religiosity that connects them to those very institutions. And this has allowed them to maintain a measured distance from the very religious institutions that indirectly validate their vernacular practices. Although their attachment to orthodoxy draws on a sense of cultural heritage and patrimony, it's not nostalgic or purely sentimental. Rather, being just orthodox allows them to reaffirm or negate relatedness, morally validate those relationships that stem from being related, and maintain the effective atmosphere of religiosity that colors their everyday lives. So this lack of familiarity among the just Orthodox with formal religious practices, doctrine, and history, which is often manifest as indifference, is what has prompted some scholars to refer to Eastern Slavs as nominally Orthodox or Orthodox in name only. But the concept of nominalism suggests that religion is not important. And after extensive ethnographic research, I've concluded that wavering commitments to an institution, as represented by the Just Orthodox, but equally applying to those with the Ukrainian Orthodox Church of the Moscow Patriarchate or the Orthodox Church of Ukraine, as well as the critical attitudes people might hold of religious leaders, cannot be equated with nominalism, aversion, or even fossilized indifference. This is pervasive soft confessionalism, and it allows for attachments to shift religious practices out of religious institutions and into the public sphere. And given religiosity, religious institutions and religious leaders an import and gives religiosity, religious institutions and religious leaders an import for politics, history, and identity formation that often does not follow traditional patterns. Some states claim secular governance over deeply religious citizenries, such as the United States. In parts of Europe, we have states that mobilize religion, sometimes in the form of state churches, for the purposes of governing populations that are deeply secular. But being religious or embracing secularism as a political principle of governance in these contexts diverge because the enabling conditions that animate religiosity have shaped them differently. Since the collapse of the USSR, I've argued that there's been a deepening of religiosity in Ukraine at the same time that the processes that foster secularism continue unabated. This leaves in its wake a society that is simultaneously increasingly religious and enduringly secular. The religious practices I observe and the inclinations to engage in them and the interpretations of their meaning are idiosyncratic and often tailored to individual needs. Yet because they are so pervasive and draw on a common Eastern Christian faith tradition, they amount to a collective expression of faith that feeds what I call this effective atmosphere of religiosity. The atmosphere that has emerged in Ukraine and the dispositions, sensibilities, and temperaments that stem from it have allowed religion to enter the public sphere, public institutions, and politics in significant ways. An effective atmosphere primes the pervasive power of religiosity and makes religiosity a political resource that now includes weaponization and securitization. So let's look more in detail at the three dynamics that enable everyday religiosity and contribute to religion becoming a political resource. Given the current level of destruction of public space and public institutions, thanks to this war, a focus primarily on vernacular religious practices. So here obviously is a picture of Sofiyskiy Sobor, St. Sofia's Cathedral in Kiev, and the gold dome cupolas are really a focal point, whether one speaks of urban squares or village centers. This cathedral stands, although it's important to note that as of last week, over 340 religious buildings have been documented as being damaged or outright leveled. And half of them are part of the Ukrainian Orthodox Church of the Moscow Patriarchate. So in addition to these sort of religious iconography in the landscape of cities and towns across Ukraine, you have a very pervasive presence of religious iconography in public space. So here on your left, you see a building that was covered with these enormous panels, Freedom is Our Religion, that has since become very much of a political slogan. To the right, you have a mural that was put up on the side of a residential building, also in central Kiev, by a Baptist group. This mural depicts, even instructs, on the Ten Commandments. To the far right there, you see each of the Ten Commandments is written in an iridescent script that glows in the dark. So at night, they're still visible. On the bottom of this mural, you have QR codes. And should one wish to find out more about each of the 10 commandments, you can use your cell phone to do so. In short, you have here a religious building that provides religious instruction, one might even say proselytizing, in central Kiev. Similarly, here to the left, this is a metro station in Kharkiv. And they're enmeshed between very profane things, such as an ATM machine and the ticket counter. You have Saint Tatiana, sort of an image that could just as easily be found on icons. And there she is in the metro. To the right, you have then clearly a Greek Catholic shrine to the Virgin Mary that has been erected on a sidewalk in right in front of commercial property. And the key point that I wish to note is that this kind of religious iconography is not only pervasive, it's interconfessional, and it's uncontroversial. That is to say, I know of no attempts to try to remove any of these. This is then compounded by the presence of clergy in public institutions, driven primarily by the development of military chaplains. During the Maidan, the clergy played a very, very key role in working with the various protesters who sought to oust the then ruling authorities in Ukraine, Viktor Yanukovych. They became known as the chaplains of the Maidan. And after the hybrid war broke out in 2014, they quickly became military chaplains. This is now an institution that has been formalized, and chaplains are now informal employees of the Department of Defense. The development of the military chaplaincy paved the way for a variety of other chaplaincies to emerge, first within, let's say, border guards and transportation hubs, but also within social institutions that cater, for example, to serving youth or what are called orphan chaplaincies, children from disadvantaged backgrounds, prisons, and the like. It has also spawned medical chaplains. There had always been, but now it's increasingly more so, worship space installed within hospitals and rehab centers, for example, and now chaplains that are assigned to those spaces. Here you see some of military chaplains at work. It's also important to note that the Roman Catholic Church and various Protestant religious groups, specifically from the US, have a considerable experience with chaplaincies, and they lent a great deal of their expertise to Ukraine so as to both create and get these chaplaincies up and running. So in other words, we see here influence coming from religious groups that are primarily located abroad that are helping to shape chaplaincies of all forms within Ukraine. And there's no corresponding dynamics, of course, in Russia on that front. Given that the chaplaincy began as a military chaplaincy most recently, and it sort of carries an ethos of serving God and country. And so the kind of the moral validation to restore a sense of violated justice permeates a great deal of the chaplaincies. It also raised the question very early on, can clergy from the Ukrainian Orthodox Church of the Moscow Patriarchate serve as military chaplains, given after 2014, the Russian support for the insurgency there? And the answer rendered was no, by the Verkhovna Rada. And this, of course, then served to formalize perceptions of a pro-Russian church, the Ukrainian Orthodox Church of the Moscow Patriarchate, and once it was created, the Orthodox Church of Ukraine as pro-Ukrainian. It's also important to note, though, that members of the clergy of the Ukrainian Orthodox Church of Moscow Patriarchate did serve informally, both on the Maidan and as military chaplains, but they were obliged to serve as volunteers. The overall point I wish to make is that your average Ukrainian citizen prior to the invasion, and both in public space and in public institution, encounters religiosity on a steady basis. Now let's turn to vernacular religious practices. So when deinstitutionalized religious practices are set within the kind of effective atmosphere of religiosity created by the presence of religious signs and clergy in public institutions as they are in Ukraine, this yields a responsiveness to religion and an ability to use religion to drive collective action. The Just Orthodox participate in various forms of nomadic religion, nomadic orthodoxy, as it has been called, and that refers then to pilgrimages, processions, another religiously inspired movement that also takes place in public space. These practices create temporary, non-coercive communities that are quickly assembled for specific purposes and, once fulfilled, quickly dissolved. So by inscribing religiosity in public space, one can consider oneself meaningfully Orthodox without ever entering a church. The religiosity of the Just Orthodox exists in the spaces between institutional religion and the places where everyday life unfurls. The Just Orthodox are non-practicing only in the sense of formal religious rituals. They care that a tomos has been granted and an independent Orthodox Church of Ukraine has been created, but they don't care enough to actively participate in institutional religious life, primarily because there are myriad possibilities for practicing religion beyond institutional confines and even a preference to do so. So this atmosphere of religiosity and the prevalence of religious iconography and clergy in public institutions then serves as fuel, if you will, for these vernacular religious practices, which puts in place an upward spiral. So religion is extremely important in Ukraine at this juncture because it informs and at times defines relatedness, and investigating how religious practices and concepts create relatedness. We can see this in these vernacular religious practices, and let me just give you a sense of some of them. This is the common practice of lighting a candle, which people frequently do when they have some kind of a desire, need, or what have you. Here you see people placing prayer requests. To the left is a slide of people placing prayer requests within a church, but to the right, it's at a cemetery. People write out their requests, and those are then given to monks who, with their learned piety, then intercede for them. This is one of my favorites. This is the Epiphany, which is on January 19th, where one reenacts the baptism of Christ in the River Jordan. The only problem is that in this part of the world, you generally have snow and ice everywhere. That, however, doesn't in any way daunt people. And here you have another example of vernacular religious practice that uses water and purification that water delivers. And by the way, this picture was taken also in February. There's snow and ice all around too. And here you have people bathing in what is a sacred spring. Most pilgrimages either incorporate or culminate in immersing oneself in a sacred spring. Here's another example of that sense of bathing in a sacred spring for its healing, purifying, or otherwise sacred qualities, however understood. And once again, sort of illustrating the pervasiveness of that, here, this is a public park in Kharkiv in eastern Ukraine. This is also considered a sacred spring within a public park. And you have an iconostasis like image there standing before an opening in the ground in the shape of a cross where people similarly bathe. So in thinking about how then these engaging in these kinds of vernacular practices could begin to forge a sense of relatedness, I'd like to suggest that vernacular religiosity links individuals through horizontal forms of social cohesion or vertical forms of solidarity that connect them to groups, to the dead, to the divine, or to a civilizational ascetic tradition through lived forms of religion. And this reveals the relevance of religion in the lives of individuals or in members of a particular group. And this is, I think, more important than, for example, questions regarding belief, participation in formal religious rituals, or any kind of stated religious affiliation. Understandings of relatedness color the atmosphere that shapes life worlds and the context in which perceptions, orientations, and religious affiliations and political behaviors, including the will to fight, form. Vernacular religious practices with their recourse, as you saw, to water and graves also reveal the extent to which a place is embedded in entangled histories that interweave institutional religion with these customary practices. Religion entangles people together, and the existence of these entanglements is evidenced in interlocking paths and the present everyday lives of peoples and places that inform hierarchies of space, colonial reflexes, and institutional frameworks, all of which inform the conditions of how spaces and peoples are interconnected. Religion and specifically vernacular practices also inform in a very fundamental way a sense of temporal orientation, not just spatial attachment. Many people are familiar with the debates over which day to commemorate the ending of World War II. Should that be May 8th, as is the case in Europe, or Victory Day, as in May 9th? And this is, of course, a tremendously contested issue. Another issue that has arisen is which calendar should institutional churches use, the Julian, as it currently does, or the Gregorian. But once again, we know in diaspora communities, this has been a very fraught issue. And I suspect it will be equally as fraught in Ukraine. And one of the reasons why it's fraught is because it begins to stimulate certain dynamics of belonging. This spatial and temporal orientation situates a person in time and space and connects them to others, or divides them from others. So why affiliate with the Ukrainian Orthodox Church of the Moscow Patriarchate? So I'll answer this in two parts. This is prior to the invasion. It's important to note that not all clergy have or had ideological motivations for becoming clergy in this particular church. Indeed, in some regions of Ukraine, often it was the only church. And that's, of course, a legacy of the Soviet period. For many, especially just Orthodox, they did not, prior to the invasion, they did not see the Ukrainian Orthodox Church of the Moscow Patriarchate as an arm of the Russian Orthodox Church in their city, town, or village. Rather, they considered a particular church building to be their church. And that is primarily because of personalized attachments to a particular building. Perhaps their parents helped renovate it. Perhaps they had a child baptized there. Perhaps they consider it their neighborhood church. There's a variety of reasons that might attach a person to a particular building. Also, in speaking with many just Orthodox and those who are of the Ukrainian Orthodox Church of the Moscow Patriarchate, some perceived the Orthodox Church of Ukraine as a new artificial entity created to serve the political needs of the Ukrainian state. And this somehow makes it lesser, certainly lesser authentic in their eyes. There's often an assumption that historically grounded churches or sacred spaces are somehow more spiritual, more authentic. And this conviction is reflected in vernacular concepts such as ideas about places animated with prayer, namolene miste or namolene miesta, which are usually historic churches or sites. However, once you have the beginning of the invasion on February 24th of this year, and here I put this up, I think this was a very effective statement. This was in Rynok Square in Lviv. Just three weeks into the war, they put out 109 strollers to symbolize the 109 children that were killed so far in the war. So once you have an invasion, then the question has to shift to why stay with the Ukrainian Orthodox Church of the Moscow Patriarchate? And the war has, of course, placed this institution in an extremely difficult position, which is already deemed untenable by some clergy and believers alike. And I think the condemnation of the Ukrainian Orthodox Church of the Moscow Patriarchate will likely be louder the longer the war drags on. Even before 2014, the Ukrainian Orthodox Church of the Moscow Patriarchate was accused of contributing to Russification and embodying ideologies from Moscow and Ukraine, including the Russian world, not only as a church, but also through its brotherhoods, missions, and other associations. After 2014, some refused to pray for the civil authorities, as one says, and given the Ruski Mir, the Russian world, and the propagating of this doctrine, interpretation of civil authorities was increasingly equated with Vladimir Putin himself. So you initially then after 2014, you have people and churches refusing to acknowledge him. Additionally, narratives about a fratricidal civil war in eastern Ukraine, thereby exempting Russia from inciting or sustaining the armed insurgency, also became objectionable. And this led to then further criticism of the Ukrainian Orthodox Church of the Moscow Patriarchate, and a rejection of the concept of political orthodoxy, which gained currency, celebrating the relationship between church and state in Ukraine, increasingly one that was emerging as a relationship between the church and a protective allegiance with people. Similarly, after the annexation of Crimea and the beginning and the annexation of certain dioceses in Donetsk and Lugansk, the Ukrainian Orthodox Church of the Moscow Patriarchate did not object to those annexations. When you add to that a series of statements made by Patriarch Kirill, and these statements, of course, really begin to strain a sense of relatedness and belonging. From the first day, Patriarch Kirill offered no clear condemnation of the war, although the Metropolitan Onufri, who leads the Ukrainian Orthodox Church of the Moscow Patriarchate, did. The justification for war that he offers is to protect the Russian world, an entity of co-believers that mirrors to a large extent the former frontiers of the Russian Empire as a fortress against corrupt, liberal European values. And of course, in doing so, Kirill echoes Vladimir Putin's assertion that Russians and Ukrainians are essentially one people. And so to most, this rings hollow in the face of Russian forces' unbridled targeting of civilians, civilian infrastructure, and by that I include religious infrastructure. This is then, so after offering no condemnation, he then begins to offer a justification, and specifically on Forgiveness Sunday. His claims of the travesty of Europa and an interpretation of this war as a clash of civilizations, of good against evil, of defense of God-given attributes against free choice, sharpens the difference between the two churches. In short, he asserted that we need this war because we can't have gay pride parades. And with this, we really see the beginning of at least two orthodoxies developing, one championing traditional values as reflected in conservative gender-based identities and roles, even if it means destruction of human life, and the other not. So then, adding from first non-condemnation to justification, now to an attempt to almost inspire violence, this statement was issued after the so-called partial mobilization in Russia to try to stem the flow of young men out of the country. So Patriarch Kirill not only validates the killing of Ukrainians in this fratricidal war, but likens it to a purifying sacrifice that a soldier makes on behalf of others. And for those of us who study religious, politicized religious rhetoric, it of course has direct echoes of jihadist rhetoric. And I thought I would end it there, but actually he recently just last week came out with yet another. Attempts to not only once again inspire, but the denazification rhetoric is not working as much. And so we have shifted to a rhetoric of desatanization. So such statements have inspired a variety of initiatives to remake shared religious traditions and practices specifically so that there are deliberate and visible differences between the Orthodox Church of Ukraine and the Ukrainian Orthodox Church of the Moscow Patriarchate and the Russian Orthodox Church. So in addition to such statements, that the Ukrainian Orthodox Church of the Moscow Patriarchate must contend with the fact that few moments illustrate the quasi-religious reverence dead bodies command more than when they are buried unceremoniously. And the vigorous support for the war that Kirill has offered is compounded by mounting evidence of mass atrocities committed in Bucha, Mariupol, Izum, and elsewhere. So for many in Ukraine, this rises to the level of genocide being perpetrated against Ukrainians. Exhumation has shown that some corpses were violently marked by post-death castration and even beheading. So in a war crimes court, these mutilated bodies will speak as witnesses and tell of what transpired. These dead bodies will spare the living the pain of recounting their own trauma as they testify to the crimes against humanity committed in a mounting number of Ukrainian cities and towns at the hands of Russian forces. So although there have been incremental changes over the years, and I do think it's important to note this, to explain the levels of affiliation among the Ukrainian Orthodox Church of the Moscow Patriarchate and the attitude of just Orthodox. For example, some members of the Moscow Patriarchate clergy did indeed participate on the Maidan that was successfully ousted the pro-Russian Ukrainian president, even though they were forbidden to do so. And after armed combat began in eastern Ukraine in 2014, some, as I mentioned earlier, did indeed refuse to pray for civil authorities during services because it implied President Putin, and they also began to substitute references to our land with direct mention of Ukraine. And since the invasion and the statements from Patriarch Kirill, some have also refused to mention him in services. They are, of course, considered schismatics. But in April 2022, a petition to the global Orthodox leadership, signed by over 400 clergy of the Moscow Patriarchate, sued Patriarch Kirill in the Council of the Primates of the Ancient Eastern Churches. That's the highest governing, that's the highest court governing Orthodox jurisdictions worldwide. Ukrainian Orthodox Church Moscow Patriarchate clergy charged Kirill with preaching the doctrine of the Russian world, which they claim is heresy. And they charged him with moral crimes of blessing the war against Ukraine and fully supporting Russian aggression against a civilian population. And they call for Kirill to be removed as patriarch and declare any further canonical subordination to him and the Russian Orthodox Church as impossible. So this is evidence of great bottom-up pressure from people to priests to make significant changes. And this is where pressure of switching from the Julian to the Gregorian calendar, I think, is likely to arise, because an apolitical neutral stance as an affiliate of the Ukrainian Orthodox Church Moscow Patriarchate or as a non-affiliated just Orthodox is increasingly difficult to maintain as this war drags on and the list of atrocities grows. So what to do with the Ukrainian Orthodox Church of the Moscow Patriarchate? So of course, one suggestion is quite simply to outlaw the church. It's important to note that prior to the invasion, that Ukraine earned remarkably high scores when it came to religious tolerance and respect for freedom of conscience prior to 2022, which of course might vanish if the state began to outlaw certain denominations. We saw the tremendous interest that human rights groups exhibited when it was no longer possible for clergy from the Ukrainian Orthodox Church of the Moscow Patriarchate to serve as military chaplains in a war situation. Having said that, the Ukrainian Orthodox Church of the Moscow Patriarchate is already banned in some local jurisdictions, but there is, as of now, no national ban. So another option might be, of course, the status quo. You saw in earlier survey data that only 4% of the Ukrainian population claims to be affiliated, and people could quite simply continue to vote with their feet and allow it to become a shell of an institution with very few parishioners. And there are proposals to oblige the Ukrainian Orthodox Church of the Moscow Patriarchate to indicate its subordination to Moscow directly in its name so that individuals, and this of course is presumably geared specifically towards the just Orthodox, would know to which church they were entering, and to give some thought as to whether it was actually just a matter of convenience after all. The next option would be, of course, unification, a merger with the Orthodox Church of Ukraine. The only issue here is we have over 12,000 parishes and those valuable monasteries. And it's hard to imagine, quite simply, just the gift of such valuable, such vast and valuable property. And those of us who have been studying religion for quite some time remember in the 1990s some of the tremendous difficulties, specifically in Western Ukraine, when certain church buildings were switched into different jurisdictions. It created enormous tension on the local level. So the idea of a merger is not very easy either. And some clergy of the Ukrainian Orthodox Church of the Moscow Patriarchate anticipate being marginalized, even stigmatized, as second-class clergy, should they be either forcibly or should there be a merger between the two churches at a later date. What might also happen is some kind of a split, where clergy and parishioners leave the Ukrainian Orthodox Church of the Moscow Patriarchate and form a new kind of church, just like the Ukrainian Orthodox Church of the Kiev Patriarchate did earlier, and the Ukrainian Autocephalous Orthodox Church did. So this means that we're looking at two, if not three, Orthodox churches in Ukraine. That then raises the question, as will different historical interpretations, and different political positions be enough to separate them and distinguish them? Will we be witnessing new theological orientations emerging? Might Ukraine be the source of an alternative to the kind of traditional values that the Moscow Church has offered? And we see the beginnings of this in an articulation of a Kievan tradition that rests on ecumenicism. But it's important to note that any kind of moves to split and form an independent church that presumably would not be canonically recognized would begin to really entrench Ukraine as the first predominantly Orthodox country to break with established organizational patterns and have multiple churches. All of these options that I've outlined here are fraught with difficulties. And I think we're likely to see very creative solutions emerging, proving once again the generative capacities of violence. So let's consider then the aftermath of this war. I'm an eternal optimist, so I think it's important to consider that. I think a good bit will depend on how each of these institutions addresses issues of dispossession. And that is the topic of my current research. And by dispossession, I mean not just the loss of land, property, or infrastructure, but the loss of status and networks. Displacement and economic collapse have squelched professional identities and networks of colleagues. Families are now separated in different countries or regions, and some have lost members. Neighborhoods have been decimated, and with that, the long-standing relationships with neighbors. I could go on and on, but it's far easier to repair a bridge and build new roads than it is to reconstruct a life world. Another issue will be how to achieve a just peace. Most religious leaders around the world have concluded that this is a just war to fight. But then how does one establish some kind of an agreement as to what constitutes a just form of peace, and one that will address the myriad forms of dispossession that have been inflicted on Ukrainians? So the irony is that given the social capital, the clergy continues to hold, I think religious organizations are likely to be key drivers of processes of reconciliation or a prolongation of conflict and social tensions in the aftermath of war. Even an end to armed combat is unlikely to deliver peace. Many anticipate a form of what's been called porcupine militarism to take root in Ukraine as borders are fortified to somewhat reduce violence, as it does between Israelis and Palestinians, the Irish and Northern Irish, and in Bosnia. But in each of these instances, the ever-present potential for violence remains palpable. I do think in such a context, religious minorities will once again play an outsized role in political life. Minority religious groups with strong bases in Ukraine and beyond, especially the Greek Catholics, the Baptists, and a plethora of Protestant groups, Jews, Muslims, to name only a few, efficiently deliver humanitarian aid currently. And it's important to note that they sometimes do it even to areas under siege, such as Mariupol, and when, for example, the Red Cross or UNICEF won't enter zones of armed combat, active combat. The influence and the impact of these religious minorities far exceeds their numbers in Ukrainian society. And this is also a distinguishing factor of the religious landscape in Ukraine when compared to Russia. There is no counterpart in Russia to the vast involvement of transnational religious networks, religious institutions and resources located beyond Ukrainian borders, but active within Ukraine, have resulted in a reduction of othering, as we were reminded when we saw the chief rabbi of Kyiv, who sang the Ukrainian national anthem on Purim, and other rabbis who made YouTube statements pleading in Russian to Russians as Russian-speaking Jews to protest Russian military campaigns to denazify them. So just to wrap up, the creation of a group of people who see themselves as just Orthodox in particular reflects the important role of religion in defining public space, public institutions, and informing self and collective perceptions, particularly as they define who one is related to, who one feels an obligation to, and where one belongs. Prior to the war, the Just Orthodox were also emblematic of the religious pluralism and tolerance for a broad spectrum of attitudes towards faith and towards inclusive forms of deinstitutionalized religious practices that brought sympathizers, agnostics, and the pious together. Given the growing militarization in both Ukraine and Russia, when this war ends and we take inventory of all that has been destroyed, I suspect there will be far fewer just Orthodox and massively transformed understandings of relatedness between Russians and Ukrainians that will inscribe themselves on the Ukrainian Orthodox Church of the Moscow Patriarchate. But I surely hope that among the casualties, we will not find that the pluralism and acceptance and tolerance for difference that the just Orthodox once embodied will be among those casualties. So thank you for your attention.
Thank you so much. So I think if you join me here, is that the way to do that? We'll move the camera angle here. So we have time for questions from you, the audience, and for those of you who are watching online, I'll be looking for your questions as well. We already have a few, but I think I'll start by asking the first question, if no one minds. And I'd like to pick up a little bit on where you ended in this kind of idea of tolerance and multi-religiosity. I think this is something we've heard a lot of Ukrainians talk about that makes Ukraine different and specifically different from Russia. But when you were talking about the sort of temporal and spatial orientation, and then you brought up Patriarch Kirill's remarks about Europa and these same rhetorics that we've heard from this conservative Russian regime, I wonder if you can make those connections between that kind of spatial temporal orientation, diversity, multi-religiosity, multi-ethnicity, and this, I mean, I hate to use the word backward looking, but there's an association of the idea of tolerance with Europe and democracy, right? And Russian authoritarianism as not accepting those things. So I had all these threads going, and I wonder if maybe you can kind of bring them together for us, because I think they all go together.
They do. Orthodoxy, whether one speaks about the Ukrainian Orthodox Church of the Moscow Patriarchate and by extension the Russian Orthodox Church or the Orthodox Church of Ukraine, they clearly share liturgical traditions, an aesthetic tradition. In short, they share many things. So in other words, efforts I see are being made to really forge clear differences between them. And I think that's where one sees the whole issue of the calendar, of course, is a very expedient, albeit controversial, way of really forging two different kinds of, two different tracks, if you will, of different religious practices. So there are those ways to forge differences. I think it's too early to say whether we're going to see theological differences emerging, but we already see, on one level, some differences in social policies emerging. In other words, the stated aim of trying to join the European Union means that, for example, when there are, let's say, gay pride parades, once again, sort of a public action in public space, that there's pressure in Ukraine to make certain that these are nonviolent. The fact that they occur, granted they occur on a Sunday morning at 8 a.m., that helps quell the violence in and of itself, that talk about using time and space. In short, an effort to embrace social policies, or at least express views on social policies that are not articulated, which means a rejection of these kinds of traditional values, which means then a relaxation of the condemnation of homosexuality or any understanding of marriage that isn't necessarily between a man and a woman, gets framed somewhat differently in Ukraine thus far. That's not to say that, you know, that there's an open progressive agenda underway in Ukraine, but the fact that there's a move away from celebrating these kinds of highly traditional gender-based roles and identities is already significant in and of itself. So I think the overall point is we see different spatial orientations when it comes to not just historical interpretation, but commemorating certain historical events. This begins to scope out a certain understanding of space and being attached to a particular place. When you start talking about the calendar, you see a different kind of temporal orientation that begins to emerge, a different positions, political and other positions on social issues being taken, so as to distinguish religious life in Ukraine from religious life in Russia and by extension elsewhere also. You see a certain momentum building, and arguably not far behind perhaps could be theological differences. And so this merits our attention because we see the emergence perhaps of two different kinds of orthodoxies that potentially could be playing out in Russia and Ukraine that could have reverberations for other predominantly Orthodox societies in the region, as well as elsewhere, such as here in North America.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Sorry, please go ahead.
First of all, thank you very much for this presentation.
Oh, I'm so sorry. We do have a microphone so that you can be picked up for our streaming audience. Yes. Thanks so much.
Thank you very much for this presentation and for really focusing on, it looks like, till recently, the largest religious group in Ukraine. 99% of the research in religion and religiosity in Ukraine avoids the largest group, one of the largest groups. So it is important and significant in its own right. I have two questions. The first one is whether the polling data that we have allows us to create a portrait of the just Orthodox, where that person lives, whether it would be a woman or a man, again, what the percentages are, whether it would be a dweller of a village, of a small town, of a city. So I wonder if there is that data and we can really create that portrait. And the second question deals with the analysis that you presented. So you looked at three different factors that contribute to the creation of the just Orthodox person. And then the fourth one is the war and Russia's policies. that pushes people outside of that space. And I wonder, maybe that means that there is more than four factors that are there that create that space, because again, the war per se doesn't affect either the presence of religious symbols or the vernacular religiosity. So maybe there is also something related to the ethnic identity or national identity that also is a formative factor for that space of just Orthodox. And related to that possibility is maybe the people are being pushed out of that space into a space that is not yet categorized by the anthropologists or by those who are doing polls. Maybe they're becoming just Ukrainian Orthodox, in a sense that other characteristics, apart from this affiliation, national affiliation or state national affiliation, maybe they don't change, or maybe they do. Again, I understand that it's maybe impossible to answer in particular the last question, but if you could comment on that.
Sure. So you've got several questions there. That's okay. No, that's okay. They're all interesting and they're all somewhat interrelated. In terms of demographic data, the most interesting part is it's more pronounced in Eastern and Southern Ukraine, in particular, this sort of just Orthodox orientation. I see this just Orthodox orientation as being essentially a political statement. I mean, in other words, I was trying to say that in looking at those who might, let's say, declare an affiliation with the Ukrainian Orthodox Church of the Moscow Patriarchate, it's not that they don't engage in vernacular religious practices or they're not exposed to that religious iconography in public space. The difference being their attachment might be to a particular church building which is under that jurisdiction. In other words, attitudes are fairly similar. Someone who's just Orthodox doesn't perhaps necessarily feel an attachment to a particular building. It's a wide-ranging, amorphous attachment, but it's quite real. It's to a confessional tradition, but it really does anchor them within Ukraine. And I think the most interesting demographic characteristic, it's specifically the areas where the fighting is the most intense, where you have the greatest number of just Orthodox. And so the pressure is on them to perhaps make other kinds of political, use their a stated religious affiliation to other political means. I understand those who claim to be just Orthodox, in part to be doing so because they would like Orthodoxy to not be anywhere near as politicized and as instrumentalized as it has been for quite some time now. And that is one way for them to, on their own, depoliticize it and return it to something that is much more purely spiritual in and of itself. As to whether there's anything specific about being just Orthodox in Ukraine, and specifically, I'll try to link your second and third questions here a bit. What I think it makes a huge difference is the Ukrainian Greek Catholic Church. When I mentioned, for example, that religious minorities have an impact and influence that far surpasses their numeric presence within Ukrainian society, that is first and foremost true of the Ukrainian Greek Catholic Church, which, although it might have a regional base in Western Ukraine, I think is increasingly seen and sees itself as a national institution that serves Ukrainians. But it's also important to note, for those that might not know, the Ukrainian Greek Catholic Church, of course, also has a Byzantine rite. And so, of course, in many respects, there are certain, when you speak in terms of liturgy, there are certain similarities, but with very, very significant difference that it is under the Pope. It's integrated within the greater Catholic Church. This is very, very much of a distinguishing factor. And the fact that I would say that there's great acceptance and even admiration for the Ukrainian Greek Catholic Church. Those just Orthodox who are going to find that it's no longer tenable to declare themselves just Orthodox, it's entirely conceivable to me that some would perhaps affiliate with the Ukrainian Greek Catholic Church, which of course increasingly is moving beyond Western Ukraine. It moved its archiepiscopal see from Lviv to Kiev in 2005, and it is increasingly present in far beyond Western Ukraine. So that, that I think opens the door to the kind of considering ecumenicism within an Eastern Christian tradition of being a defining aspect of Orthodoxy within Ukraine. And so at this particular juncture, I would expect that under the conditions of war, that you would have growing numbers of people using a stated religious affiliation to go in support of the Orthodox Church of Ukraine, a distinctly Ukrainian or Ukrainian anchored in Kiev church. Having said that, I think these kinds of vernacular religious practices and the presence of religious iconography in public space and the presence of clergy in public institutions, all of this, if anything, is likely to intensify over time. And so the question is, under entirely different kinds of circumstances, will these swing voters, as I was calling them, will they continue to affiliate with the Orthodox Church of Ukraine or revert, whether in name or certainly in practice, I think, as just Orthodox, or, as I mentioned, move to the Greek Catholic Church or any other church. But the what I think will be distinctive about Orthodoxy in Ukraine is that there is this wide spectrum pioneered by the Ukrainian Greek Catholic Church, but also followed by a Protestant, a wide spectrum of Protestant, although they come in at under 2% of the population. After the Ukrainian Orthodox Church of the Moscow Patriarchate, the greatest number of religious buildings are those that belong to Baptists, because of course they were so prominent and prevalent in parts of Eastern and Southern Ukraine. So they in particular have been disproportionately affected by this war. And it's also important to note when one considers the experience of religious minorities, as concerns the Protestants, for example, you see a split between a far clearer break between co-religionists in Russia and co-religionists in Ukraine. And that's true certainly for a wide spectrum of Baptist, of Protestant communities and Muslim communities as well, where there's been a formal split. So in other words, a consolidation among religious minorities is occurring that continues to anchor them within Ukraine. And I think this too will continue to be an influence on however Orthodoxy might continue to develop over time in Ukraine.
Hi, thank you so much. When you were speaking about just Orthodox, you mentioned soft confessionalism. And could you elaborate on that? What exactly does that mean? And then the second thing I have, it's sort of a comment, question comment, I suppose. When you, the ritual and baptism and purification of the sacred waters, it seems that that might be a unification for all three religions. Mm-hmm.
To your first point about, I think they kind of blend your two questions. They're good questions. The soft confessionalism, what I mean by that is people have an allegiance to a particular confessional tradition that is genuine, that is sincere, and that is meaningful. That doesn't necessarily translate into an institutional allegiance. So in other words, the just Orthodox, this large group within, or what had been a very large group within Ukraine, might feel an attachment to things Eastern Christian, but not necessarily to the institutions. They're able, the soft confessionalism allows one to divorce aspects of institutional life, or did under certain conditions, allow one to divorce aspects of institutional life and institutional authority from other kinds of spiritual or sacred authorities and other ways of being orthodox, let's say, or practicing one's religion that is going to be almost alongside institutional life, but not necessarily within it. And that's an interesting and unusual situation whereby one can see oneself as meaningfully religious in a particular confessional tradition, and considering the institution and the leaders of those institutions of secondary importance. But the wide array of these kinds of vernacular practices allows that to be possible. It also allows for religiosity to be galvanized. This idea of, for example, a person might, for example, many people go on pilgrimage. The same people who might not necessarily show up in church might go on pilgrimage and might participate in these, you know, bathing in sacred waters, whether it's in a local public park or near a monastery or wherever those sacred waters might be. And that indirectly connects them to a certain kind of confessionalism without necessarily being of a purely institutional nature. And that's what I meant about the deinstitutionalization of religious practices. You have people engaging in religious practices that is connected to a certain confession, but not necessarily connected to a certain institution. And that connection is meaningful. And that's why people claim that they are, they claim that they're Orthodox, even though they might claim they're not religious, not affiliated, and as I mentioned, might not know aspects of doctrine or other kinds of things that one would expect from someone who feels such a commitment to a particular confessional tradition. So that's what I mean about a soft confessionalism. It's meaningful, but in a way that we don't often see. Within a Christian context anyway, especially.
So Oksana and then David.
Thank you, Cassie. That was fascinating as always. I have two quick questions. One is kind of following on the previous question about the just Orthodox. We see, according to the polls that you showed, there has been some decline, right, in the number of these Orthodox. Do we have some idea of like where do these people go, right? If they stop being just Orthodox, do they become more like kind of non-religious at all, or more likely to support the Orthodox Church of Ukraine, right? Especially with the war impact. I wonder if you know anything about that. And my second question, kind of this four scenarios, or how, when you were outlining the possible future, right, of the Moscow Patriarchy, if you have some thoughts of sort of which one is more likely and why, I guess, like that would be a question. And more specifically, I was just in the news recently, I think just a few days ago. And I think if I remember correctly, it may be for the first time that the SBU found actually direct evidence of Moscow Patriarchy, you know, supporting Ruski Mir kind of project in Kirovograd, that they raided the Eparchy building, right? Like the central office, and found all sorts of propaganda materials and so forth. And it seems like they're investigating now some of these priests, right? Because it's sort of one thing if there is just a narrative as to like this is an arm of Moscow, you know, state and or church. And it's another thing if there is actually evidence, right, to that effect. And I wonder if you think that might make a difference, or is it, you know, potentially not to the scenarios that you outlined? Thank you.
Those are also two good questions. I mean, I do think at this particular juncture, the temptation is great to make a political statement with one's religious affiliation. And so I think the immediate beneficiary of the reduction in the just Orthodox and in those who previously might have been affiliated with the Ukrainian Orthodox Church of the Moscow Patriarchate, the benefit is, of course, the Orthodox Church of Ukraine. And perhaps that will carry on in the future. But if there is, and this gets to your question about what's the most likely, I think all of those options are fraught with many, many, many logistical and other challenges. But I do think the most likely is some kind of a split of the Moscow of the Moscow Patriarchate within Ukraine. In other words, some kind of enduring representation of the Russian Orthodox Church more overtly as such, and perhaps those clergy and believers who, for whatever reason, I can speculate in a moment on what those reasons might be, might wish to not join the Orthodox Church of Ukraine and might be inclined to go with this new church that probably will not be canonically recognized, but might have a degree of autonomy. I think that's probably the likeliest scenario. And I think clergy and individuals might go for the, for a variety of reasons, might go for that to the extent that they understand a certain kind of authenticity in that church, however that is understood, whether it's the building itself as being old and or what have you, relics that are in it or something of that nature. I think that's probably the likeliest scenario. I think for it's the clergy are the ones who are in a trickier situation to the extent that they, many feel the rhetoric at times, depending on it, can be shrill coming from the Orthodox Church of Ukraine. And they might feel that given if at this point in time, this deeply into the war, when, as I mentioned, the kinds of atrocities that we've seen in Bucha, Mariupol are now well established and well documented, if they still have been are affiliated with the Ukrainian Orthodox Church of the Moscow Patriarchate, that potentially that longstanding allegiance could be potentially problematic in a new kind of institutional setting. And so I think they are probably likely to create something new whereby they could recast or reframe what the Ukrainian Orthodox Church of the Moscow Patriarchate might have been and what it might become or if there is this separation of the two. I think for a great many people, either they assume that that level of collaboration always existed. There's, I think, strident assumptions that collaboration, and if not collaboration, at least collaboration in terms of Russification was an aspect of the Ukrainian Orthodox Church of the Moscow Patriarchate. And I think prior to the invasion, for some people, that was enough. I would only anticipate that now, that's going to be more than enough for ever greater numbers of people. So I think this is yet another thing.
Well, I want to start by saying what an interesting talk it was. And I just sort of, by the side, you know, how helpful it was that you had slides. You had a very academic subject. You could have done it without slides, but having slides made it so more understandable. I just wanted to put that out there. And I sort of had two questions. They're both very, I think, simple to answer, black and white. I think first thing is about soldiers on the front line. You know, when you're going out to, you know, attack the next day, you know, you're going to pray, even if you're not religious, you're going to pray forgiveness and everything else, aren't you? Because you're going to possibly die. So military chaplains, am I to understand, I'm not sure you said this because maybe I wasn't paying attention enough, but I assume that Zelensky has said that we cannot have any Moscow Patriarch military chaplains. You have to be of the other Kiev. That's one question for you to clarify. Mm-hmm. The second question is, I was thinking, you know, is there anything in history, world history, which is remotely similar to this, where you have an empire which has sort of lost a section of it and has a long established church or similar institution within that lost territory, which comes back and has to deal with, you know, so this in history, I was trying to think through France, England, Greece, Rome. I can't think of anything like that, but possibly there is. That's all. Thank you.
So just here, you know, there's an old expression that that one can hear quite frequently in Ukraine, of there's no atheists on the front. That's coming out of World War II. People frequently say that. But in speaking with military chaplains, I mean, many of them said that they there's no shortage of atheists, which I was surprised myself to hear, that leaves them undaunted nonetheless. And they, you're correct. I mean, you understood correctly that technically, overtly, as formal employees of the Ministry of Defense, as official military chaplains, the Ukrainian Orthodox Church of the Moscow Patriarchate is not allowed to serve. Having said that, there are enormous numbers of volunteers that are there and are indeed, that were there. There were at one point there. And so they have been serving, but in an informal capacity. Because quite simply, you know, where the war is being waged, you have a great number of people who are had been, their local church very often was the Ukrainian Orthodox Church of the Moscow Patriarchate. So that has to do with then the chaplains. In terms of empire, I think probably the Orthodoxy, the reason why you were thinking about France and England and the like, especially because when you speak of within Catholicism, for example, there isn't this sense of perhaps a particular brand of Catholicism might emerge in, say, in France versus some former French colonies. But there isn't the same kind of sense of one people, one church as an organizational model that one has within Orthodoxy. And after, of course, after the First World War, this is, you know, when we had the breakup of a variety of empires, we also then subsequently have the creation of certain Orthodox churches. And I think perhaps one could liken this to the former Yugoslavia, where we also have had churches created to reflect certain groups of people that are co-ethnics, for lack of a better word, co-ethnics and co-believers. So for example, in other predominantly non-Orthodox countries where one might have Orthodox churches, they very often carry an ethnic qualifier, if you will. You know, the Rokor, the Russian Orthodox Church or the Ukrainian Orthodox Church. So in other words, I think it goes, it's a specific model that pertains to Orthodox churches that is very separate and distinct from, be it a Protestant one that might be very particularistic, but it doesn't carry an ethnic cast. So when you think about, let's say, the Dutch Empire and you know, in creation of Protestant or Catholic communities in their formal colonial holdings, they don't seek to create, you know, a Dutch form of Catholicism or what have you, and that's really what makes the difference. And so, of course, in a place like Ukraine, you know, making the argument that, you know, nearly 30 years of independent statehood under that kind of organizational model, there really should be a separate and distinct Orthodox Church of Ukraine. And I think that was an argument that, of course, especially under these circumstances, was persuasive come 2019.
So I'm going to draw just a couple of questions from our online audience, and we'll definitely, yes, you'll get the next one from the room or possibly the last one. So thanks again to our online audience for staying around for the whole talk. We've got so many great questions. You've actually addressed several of them already. So you're thinking along the same lines. So we have one from Anna Bisicalo, which I'm going to combine a little bit with one from Brent Weaver. So Anna is asking, do you think that the availability of or willingness to engage in deinstitutionalized religious practices is related to adaptations that religious believers made in the Soviet period? Is this different in Ukraine than in other post-Soviet contexts? And then Brent is also asking about the uptick in religious practices. Is there an uptick in personal faith as the Just Orthodox move to identify themselves with the Ukrainian Orthodox Church? Is it more of a political statement to identify with that church, or is it an, do you find that it's actually an example of a deepening or a shifting or a changing of people's faith?
So to Anna's first question, I mean, of course, I think the Soviet period where one having done research on religious practices during the Soviet period, I was kind of stunned at the degree to which there was fairly, so to my mind at that time, having read all that Soviet propaganda and the, noted the anti-religious campaigns, there was a surprising degree of resilient religious practice. The distinguishing feature was that it largely was not meant to be legible to state officials. That is to say, people certainly practice their religion, but in a either in a private kind of a sphere, a home sphere, or sometimes when they did it in public, but just not overtly religious, so as to be able to be read on what one could say by Soviet officials. So I think that is an element, certainly, that has fostered this kind of these kinds of vernacular religious practices. I think also, though, the what also has contributed it is the close association with between religion and, say, art, for example. You can find many, many Just Orthodox, for example, will have icons in their home. And they will say that they have them because they see them as beautiful and they see them as art, let's say. But once you have an icon in your home, for example, given certain conditions, that what is art in one moment can become a sacred object in another, the focal point of religious practices. And that's very, I think that's very distinctive in a way that one doesn't necessarily see that in other, in particular Christian dimensions. In terms of I would expect usually when there are, in terms of the uptick of personal faith, I see very much, especially among those who are connected to a confessional tradition as a form of heritage and as a form of that is expressed through these vernacular religious practices, that it is a form of personal faith. I think that's a fair characterization. And I would expect, given the enormous suffering that Ukrainians are experiencing today, I would expect religiosity and religious practices, appeals to otherworldly forces for strength, for healing, for all kinds of other things to mount. And correspondingly, as things become rebuilt, personally, I will be very curious to watch the extent to which I could already document it under this past 10 years that I saw that, for example, when medical facilities were being renovated or built, they increasingly deliberately from the start built in some kind of a worship space. And I might add, it was very much built in a just Orthodox kind of way. In other words, not meant to exclude, it was clearly out of an Eastern Christian tradition, but not in any way meant to exclude Greek Catholics. And I couldn't help but note that that kind of worship space was every bit as oriented towards the people who worked in those facilities as it was to perhaps patients who were there, which once again, it's I saw this as further evidence of this kind of deinstitutionalized religious practice. So your place of work then becomes a place where you express religious practices, religious sentiments, or what have you. And so I personally, when I'll be looking very carefully to see as cities and towns are reconstructed, the extent to which religious iconography will be in the landscape from the beginning, in what had been a growing pervasiveness and a religiosity in many different forms. And most of all, the really uncontroversial nature of not even just religious iconography, but even religious iconography of another confessional tradition, be it not even Eastern Christian. I can think of examples of where, for example, there's tremendous, construction, or there had been prior to the war, even of mosques and the like. And it was when one can thinks about like the controversy over minarets in Europe, there's no counterpart. I have not seen or heard that kind of counterpart in those neighborhoods where, let's say, mosques, you know, have been built. So I'll be curious to see if that that kind of religious tolerance and acceptance of a wide spectrum of confessional traditions taking place within Ukrainian public space, whether that will carry on or not. But in the book I just wrote, I wanted to nonetheless document that that was a reality in Ukraine prior to this invasion. There was a wide spectrum of religious institutions from diverse confessional traditions that were present in public space and present in public institutions. And that was accepted and was uncontroversial and was entirely tolerated. So irrespective of what comes in this aftermath, that it's important to have noted that that was a certain reality, that level of tolerance existed.
So I think we'll take one final question from the audience and then we'll wrap up. Thank you so much to everybody for sticking with our long conversation.
Thank you. Thanks for holding us such an interesting topic. So, you know, I'm really interested in how sort of the theological views within Orthodox Christianity have informed this divide. You know, it particularly seems that doctrine on the nation and the state and sort of national identity are quite unique within the Orthodoxy compared to other branches of Christianity. I'm curious if you could speak to that a little bit, you know, how the theological conception of nation and state within the Orthodox Church might be contributing to this divide that you've spoken about tonight.
I'm not a theologian, I should say, right? And I work with people who are not terribly theologically oriented, I should say. But I am telling all of my theologian friends, watch very carefully. I see, as I mentioned earlier, a variety of differences that are being crafted and enacted so as to distinguish the Orthodox Church of Ukraine from the Ukrainian Orthodox Church of the Moscow Patriarchate within within Ukraine, such as, for example, associating the civil authorities with Putin specifically, and emphasizing the connection and the subordination, certainly religiously, but politically as well, to Russia. And then we mentioned earlier, sort of, we see the beginnings of taking somewhat different positions on a variety of social issues as a way of distinguishing the two. I think theological differences are not far behind. I'm not certain which theological differences I could point to at this juncture, but I think the sheer fact that there was in attempting to block the creation of the Orthodox Church of Ukraine, the Moscow Patriarchate attempted to force other Orthodox churches to ally with it or with the Ecumenical Patriarchate, so as to impede the creation of the Orthodox Church of Ukraine. It took quite some time for other Orthodox churches to recognize the Orthodox Church of Ukraine. The Greek Orthodox, which is one of the largest and most powerful, did after quite some time. It took a year or so, but they did, and then after that you had others. And I think at this point, sort of de facto, the existence of the Orthodox Church of Ukraine has become a reality that everyone has to deal with. The question is, moving forward, what will that church be like? And I do see, to the extent that Just Orthodox now are recasting their allegiance, it is going to the Orthodox Church of Ukraine. But that is to say, they're getting these affiliates that are not particularly religiously inclined, as one generally thinks when one speaks about Christian affiliation. In other words, showing up in church on Sunday morning or officially, formally being members and the like. It's a deinstitutionalized, sincere, and pervasive form of practicing religiosity. I think if violence is generative, it's also generative for us who study religious practices. We need also to come up with new kinds of concepts and ways of thinking about how one can be religious, how one can use religion for individuals to express a particular, certainly political orientation or political position, but even sort of a greater sense of relatedness to otherworldly forces, however they might be understood. So I think I would say, stay tuned. We might very well see different kinds of theologies developing, different kinds of orthodoxies even developing. That's one thing which might come out of this war.
I think that's a fantastic forward-looking place to end. So thank you so much to the members of Zenovia Sochor Parry's family who joined us tonight. And please join me in thanking Catherine Wanner for her amazing
selection. Thanks, everyone. For those of you who usually join us, we will actually not be having a seminar next week. We will all be in Chicago for the Slavic Studies Conference. Please look at our website, huri.harvard.edu, to sign up for our listserv and find out when our next events will be. And we look forward to seeing you there.